This is a true story. Many years ago, I had been resisting getting a newfangled cell phone. I was scheduled to give a talk in Baltimore. There was a bit of snow, but I just drove the 170 miles down from University Park. If you saw the 1964 nuclear war film Failsafe with Henry Fonda as the president, nuclear bombers were dispatched and they couldn't be recalled. That was me. They called my wife Cindy at home about 20 minutes after I left and said it was too dangerous to drive. She couldn't call me. So I drove the whole way down. I arrived. I found the venue locked. I called Cindy and she said, "You are getting a cell phone," which I did. What is a cell phone, really? It's just some sand for the glass and the silicon that goes in the computer chip, some oil or other organic material for the plastic, and the right rocks, the ones with the palladium and the rare earth elements and other things, plus science and engineering and design and marketing. There's a computer chip. It's based on the transistor. That was invented by Bell Labs. That was private industry with a government-granted monopoly and Air Force money to develop it. It was designed with quantum mechanics from professors such as Bohr and Feynman who taught at universities. It connects to the internet. When I first logged onto the internet, it was the ARPANET with Department of Defense funding to UCLA and Stanford and Wisconsin to improve communications among researchers for national security reasons. When Cindy first got her GPS, the voice was a guy with a great Australian accent. My phone has a friendly sounding lady in it. So here is a very lighthearted look at how the GPS works. And if you're bored, you can think about how to redo this for the Australian guy. But for my phone, there's a lady in my phone, so I never drive alone. She tells me where to go so we get home. That nice lady in my phone, she relies on GPS, so we never get into a mess. It tells her where we are without a guess, says she relies on GPS. She listens to each satellite that she can get into her sight. They tell their time and place both day and night as she listens to each satellite. Distance from each is time times rate, so she can triangulate. 4 time differences give our place, and that works great. Distance from each is time times rate. When I first met GPS, my advisor, the late great Ian Willens at Ohio State, was using it to survey the motion of Antarctic ice streams. He had to bring the data home from Antarctica and post-process because the military was dithering them. It was called selective availability. GPS started as a U.S. military program, and then precise positioning was a secret for national security reasons. But there is complexity. Space-time is warped by gravity. To get it right, she needs relativity. For there is complexity. Einstein got that figured out. His equations work without a doubt. We're never lost when Albert is about, for Einstein got it figured out. Special and general relativity are required because the satellites move faster and are farther from Earth's gravity than clocks on Earth. It's about a 10-kilometer, 6-mile correction per day, or enough to degrade the accuracy of the phone in about 2 minutes, without relativity, we'd start to get lost in 2 minutes. And fortunately, Einstein helps the nice lady or the Australian guy in my phone. Back in the dark ages of my youth, I suspect most people would have said that quantum mechanics and relativity are the most esoteric and useless of sciences. So now, they're in our pockets, and modern life as we know it would not be possible without the technologies they enable. They come from public-private partnerships, building on university research, and based on the fact that science really works.